to be, y'all have to study who Donald Warden was, a Cotton, Turkey Calvin, I'm sure. Y'all study who he was. I think this guy right here is down there right now. Sunyata. Sunyata was from there, he come here, he was from Jersey. He was a cousin, I think, of the ex-principal. This is Sunyata. Yeah, all around Oakland, all around our masjid, everywhere, and now he's out there in North Oakland, I presume. Yeah, they have to explain their behavior. They have to explain, what did Imam Musa do for all y'all to pick up at one time and go to another place? You know? And the Book of Coincidences is, why do we have here in D.C. at least 5 or 10 rounds of people flooding the masjid, packing up and leaving? It's Oakland, it's LA, it's everywhere. So, now one plank in the platform, of course, this don't have nothing to do with y'all, is Falaiti Faki, I'll get that to them a little later. And Saba Center in Center out in, let's call it the Shia Center, and a big ex-Masonic hall down by Lake Merritt. The big Shia Center down there. You know why they open that place down there? In 89, when I left Oakland, we left Abdul Malik in charge. By 1990, all the Shias were moved out of the masjid, so they had to buy another place. So they bought the biggest shop and opened down there. But in order to do it, they had to incorporate with other non-revolutionary Shias. In the Saba Center, brothers and sisters out there, the early years of the revolution and the struggles that we went through is historical. Just people don't know that. It is a big deal. But for y'all who are out there a few miles, to not come and support Masjid al-Islam, because for the first 15 years, the only place Shias could meet in that region from Sacramento, San Francisco, Stockton, San Jose. When Ayah was held, it was held for over a decade on MacArthur Boulevard and our masjid. We carried on the greatest resistance movement up until that time. You didn't realize it. Y'all noticed that I used to tell you in all the big lectures that you didn't know what you was actually doing. But I understood what he was doing. And we survived all of that time with the United States government hating and working against everybody that supported Falaiti Faki. And now all of a sudden, all of y'all are out there at the biggest center. What are y'all doing out there? The center is so big that you have a giant program in Farsi, a giant program in Urdu, a giant program in English, and a giant program in Arabic, all at the same time. It's a big joint. You know what look y'all had on your face? Y'all had the look that the pitiful Negroes had. Boy, Imam Musa's law is all over. Y'all have the same look that the Negroes had in 1971 when this was first happening to us. You had accepted a paradigm, as they call it. What's that paradigm? When the white man puts you on the board, when the government come against you, you're through. That's the way everybody looked at me over 40 years ago. 45 years, 46, I don't know. Long time ago. It didn't happen. It didn't happen. You know why it didn't happen? Because I didn't accept their paradigm. I did not accept that when the white man scratches your name off, you scratched off. You did. Everybody else did. All of the Muslims here in D.C. and all around, they scratched me off too. This time, Imam Musa's finished. And they was looking at me with that old dumb look like, you know, I'm looking at them. I haven't seen that dumb look before. You don't know how stupid you are. It's not arrogance. But if this is a 30th go-round, 10th, 15th, I don't know the story. It was having no effect at all. And it was a total benefit. Look at Mukhtar's thing. Me standing in the doorway of the masjid after they had harassed me for an hour or so. I'm saying, okay, you act a fool, you can't come in here. Mukhtar strode, pushes in with all the other people, and I'm doing this and I'm doing that. That was 5 years ago. Everybody saw that and thought, boy, now this is finished. That was just the beginning. You look at the last thing they put on out in front of the masjid. People was talking so crazy. They ought to be in Tascadero or Napa. Y'all know that Tascadero is a crazy house. So Napa is a crazy house. Look at what they were saying. So not only did we survive, but we thrived. And we fulfilled our mission. That was what we were supposed to do at that time. We were supposed to encounter this total fitna with no help from nobody. You can't tell nobody, you can't show us anybody that came to help us. The ammunition was all blanks. They was all lied. They made a lot of noise, but they didn't hurt nobody. And now the noise is still there, recorded noise. Everything Mukhtar said was on the tape. I don't know how they control the internet, but they would say that hundreds of thousands of people would look at theirs, the new ones. And 5 or 10 people would look at mine. That ain't what's happening, dummies. That ain't what's happening. Misinformation has not worked. We've been fed misinformation since Jahiliyyah, and we haven't acted off of it. It's proved by everything that you can read. Anyway, we're going to try to speed up, because this is just to let you know where we're coming from, what we're getting ready to do. So I ask you to overlook me wanting to explain. I'm not supposed to be explaining anything to you. I'm supposed to be letting you know it's a declaration of intent. So excuse me for trying to explain. I just drifted off. So this is a message to various segments of the Bay Area Muslim society. that we reached out to everyone for all of these years, and we've talked to you about design your own future, write your own book, or the book that you want to read. We've talked to you about East Oakland Azad. East Oakland Azad is still liberating East Oakland. We're going to go back out there in a few days. We're going to reoccupy it within a couple of weeks. But we're not going to argue with anybody. We've already won the battle. Over and over again. This comes from what our mission is. Asabakum. Let's see what Asabakum means. To arrive before. To outstrip, outdistance. Leave behind. To anticipate. Or say spontaneously before one can be stopped. All this stuff, we got it. Decades and decades. We started the air war 15 years ago. So we called it. I would say it was 15 years ago because it was 2003. Around that period. It was 15 years ago. Air war, psychological war. At that time, we're going to say what needs to be said. And it's too late to stop us. See, no matter what goes on, any researcher, there's enough CDs, cassette tapes, and everything else scattered around the country that is hundreds, thousands of hours of research on our Asabakum movement. Even there's two or three websites where you can get the written Asabakums. So they're going to say spontaneously before one can be stopped, to turn spontaneously, instinctively, without knowing why. This is a protection from Allah, that you make moves instinctively without even knowing exactly why. You say certain things that are technically unplanned, and you develop an environment and you stop and think, oh yeah, that's what it is. That's from God, that's from Allah. It's too broad band, and it's too regular, and it's too sophisticated for you. The Negro is just unbelievable. But whatever it is, he had already done it before. So this is the odds from Arabic English dictionary, hands read. He already did it before. That made this thing, whatever it is done, with a psychological guerrilla warfare. Whatever it is, it's been done many times before. We go down as there has never been one before, which is unprecedented. There has never been one of those. Whatever it is, Asabakum haven't been one of them before. What could that mean for Negroes? That could mean that Negroes have never had a movement that lasts over. That's what it would mean. Without getting the stew slapped out of them before they even get a chance, the white man bumped people off before they even. It's almost they come out of the movement womb. It's like they kill babies. You know what I mean? Infanticide, you kill infants, the movement. If we get together and we want to do something for black people in 1966, and what do we want to do? We want to do this, we want to do that. And in 3 weeks, you're flooded with the United States government. You don't even know it. Nobody else knows it. They come in and they practice genocide on the movement all over America, and they kill off most of the people before they even get a chance. And the ones that they allow to go on for a while are co-opted by the police. That's what, see, they thought they was gonna knock us way back when, but they didn't. So we got a chance to go all over the world. And we found out simple things. Denmark and Sweden, now they don't like people of color there. In those days, they were the most welcome thing. These are white people way up in Europe. In the winter, you have from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock, it's daylight hours, man. You're within the Arctic Circle. In Denmark and Sweden, you look at the Arctic Circle, you're in there. In the summertime, you don't see no, it ain't dark. It's like Maghreb all night long. You know, it ain't dark. The white girls used to wait for the soldiers to come. They come from Germany up there, and they loved it. It was hated. Anybody running away from the Vietnam War could go to Denmark or Sweden and kick back. So in 1971, they had a nigga, supposed to be a pimp, called Monkey Man. The nigga got on TV and said, "All Danish men is punks, and that's why I'm here to pimp all these white girls." The nigga was a police. Even the people there didn't know he was a police. The soldiers didn't know. They weren't sophisticated enough.